I see somebody joined.
Hello, Tom.
Hey, Grace. Hey, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. Very good.
How was the roundup?
We, you know, just had our usual weekly meeting, same old. It's a litigation, which means there's like a million moving parts.
Yeah.
But it's pretty good. Britt, if you're doing this for social media, Grace Grimes will not complain. She'll give authorization.
Grace, you're about to be in the photo.
Oh, I am.
Yeah.
That's fine by me.
Don't worry, it's like a photo of you on a screen.
It's gonna end up on Klein Inspector social media, probably.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, definitely no problem with that.
So this is a tryout for me. It's going to be fun. I'm going to take the component parts of a trial and I'm going to roll through it. You're Gwen's TA for the course.
Right.
Yeah. So it's her essentially intro to trial ad. And where are they? What have they done so far in the class?
Sure. So we just got through our first case. We do a criminal murder case, and the issues are about self-defense and murder. And so they did directs, crosses, impeachment litanies, and they learned how to admit and introduce exhibits. Yeah.
Got it. Gonna add something right here.
They've also learned about themes and theories and case analysis.
Well, then this should fit right in because I'm going to talk about what a whole trial is like, and I don't think that they all might focus on direct, cross, redirect, how it unfolds and what's involved. So we'll see. Are they pretty interactive group?
Oh yeah, definitely. And I know the trial team, because that's the section that I'm the teaching assistant for. The trial team is really, really excited to participate today.
Okay. Oh, that's good. That's fun. Are they part of the class, or are they like, are they ancillary to this? They're in the class.
Yeah, they're in the class. And then every Friday is the lecture. And then the following week is the performance sections. Mm-hmm. So they're split off into, I think it's groups of eight. Mm-hmm. The trial team section is 10, and that's when they practice and sharpen their skills that they learned in the lecture the prior week.
Who's doing the, who else is coming in? Are there guest lectures through this whole thing, or does Gwen do most of the teaching?
Yeah, Gwen does the lecture on Fridays. I don't know if she has any other guest lecturers planned for the rest of the semester. I can take a look at the syllabus, but I think you're the first.
I was just curious. I think she used to do a bunch, but I think she's gone back and forth on that. There's something to the continuity of the professor in these classes, and then there's something to, you know, spicing it up a little bit. But if the people come in and they just bullshit, then it's like not worth it. In my view, they have to like have something that they really want to say.
Yeah, I'm currently in Professor Stern's ATA class too. So she does the advanced trial ad classes as well, which are awesome.
Yeah. Are you working over the semester, or are you just full-time studying? I just forget who's here and who's not.
I'm working part-time right now. So I work Tuesdays and Thursdays, and I'm often here on Fridays as well.
Mm-hmm. Where are you now? You in our office?
I'm on 12.
Yeah, okay. You were in the meeting this morning, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I saw you. Those meetings are very interesting. They're a whole different component to what used to be in the firm. It's kind of a different firm that you're joining than existed even 10 years ago. It's just a different collegial cohesive group. It's really pretty amazing place now.
In what way? How does that compare to how it used to be?
Well, we didn't have weekly meetings. things. And I think as the firm has grown in size, the amount of collaboration has grown. And I think that's been good. People just by definition work together on projects. I don't know how many pictures, many more photos you could take.
Oh, there were some from far away and some zoomed in.
Okay, that's good. You have Brittany Schoenbeck now has her social media stuff that she wants.
Thank you, Grace.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So it is 10:30. This starts at 10:30, right?
Yeah. Do we have people in?
Yeah, why don't we all go ahead and turn our cameras on, guys?
Oh, there we are. Wow.
You got a lot of people here.
That populated in a hurry.
All right, so.
Go.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and kick it off here. It's 10:30. We're gonna go ahead and get started. As you all know, Professor Stern did have to be away this weekend, but we are so thrilled and excited to have Tom Klein here to speak with us about trial advocacy and jury trials, and to impart some of his wisdom in those areas for which he is a true expert. And before I hand it over to Mr. Klein, I did just want to take a second to thank him so much for being here and to acknowledge and recognize really how cool it is that you have someone like Mr. Klein here to talk with us, because not only is he one of the best trial lawyers in the entire country who continues to obtain literal billion-dollar verdicts for his clients, but he also has the ability and has in the past changed Pennsylvania's laws through his trial advocacy and through his mastery of the skills and the techniques that we practice in this course. And I'm sure I could go for the entire hour talking about all the things that he's done and his trials and his verdicts and his accolades, but I know you're here to listen to Mr. Klein and not to listen to me talk about Mr. Klein. So without further ado, thank you so much, Mr. Klein, for being here, and the floor is yours.
Everyone knows me. They know how to spell my name. They know my middle initial, and it's nice to be here. If everybody could turn on their cameras, it would really be great. I know there's a tendency folks not to want to do it, but it would be really nice if you'd do it for me. And I promise not to be judgmental, and you won't be judgmental of me. I wore a suit today because I thought it was a good idea to dress up like a trial lawyer. So if you'd populate, it would just be great. Then I will feel more homey and welcomed. I'm still waiting for a bunch of people. I don't think I'm going to convince everybody. It's like convincing everybody to get the vaccine. There are just some people you can't convince. So this is going to be fun today, I hope. When Gwen asked me to do this lecture / presentation, there were a number of ways I could go, and I thought I would try something out on you. I want in 1 hour to think with you about the, I'm just too shy of being fully populated. So we're getting there. And look at that. I see people getting the sleepy heads out of their eyes, and it's kind of cool. So when Gwen asked me to do this, I thought, what would be a really interesting way to do a lecture, hopefully interactive, on a trial and its component parts? And that's what I'd like to talk to you about today. I've literally made myself a list, but I don't need that list really in front of me. I did that because I think we all like to have something in writing sitting in front of us. What I want to do is talk about every aspect of the trial and how it all fits together individually and collectively. Because at the end of the day, that's how you should be thinking about it. A trial is a thing. A trial is something that is an event. It's something that has component parts to it, but you should be thinking about it fully and completely. And by the way, I think Grace is the one who takes the questions, and we can work through questions, please. I want you to be interactive. You can raise your hands, you can stop me. I have a lot that I want to kind of plow through in a very disciplined fashion, but I think that we could also stop if you have things to ask and you want to talk. And by the way, I appreciate it. I see everybody but one. Bree, I'm going to call you out on the screen right now. Here goes. So I know you've been looking at various parts of trials right now. Grace filled me in on what you did last week since this course began. But my focus today is, what is a trial? A trial is an adjudication of legal rights. So you need to be looking at what your role in that trial is, what your client's role in the trial is, and what's going to happen in the entire trial. You have to look at a trial through the lens when it begins, from the opening bell of a trial. You need to look at it from what is the end going to look like. In some ways, it's a race. And oftentimes, how many of you have seen a race where the person out in front of the race loses the race, runs out of steam, runs out of ideas? I used to go to the racetrack as a young kid, and I used to like when my horse was running second, because I was looking for that sprint towards the finish line. And that's sometimes is the way a trial will work. You'd like to be out ahead the whole trial, but a trial has various opportunities throughout it, and those opportunities translate into the full and complete trial, which ends up, of course, in a verdict. So I've sketched out on a sheet of paper all of the various component parts and what you might be thinking about and what you should be thinking about accomplishing in those parts, whether you represent a plaintiff or a defendant, whether it be a criminal trial or a civil trial, whether it be a commercial dispute over a contract, or whether it be a case involving a personal injury. Most of my experience, of course, is in representing people who are catastrophically injured or in death claims in matters which arise out of various products and medical malpractice and the like. But I think that the concepts I'm going to give you here today are universal. So my first point, and these are all kind of high level, 30,000 foot view tips, if you will, are, how do you look at it? Well, for starters, you look at it as a whole. This is a trial. I need to prepare myself for how it's going to unfold, how it's going to work. I may have a great piece of evidence, but I may decide that piece of evidence will fit best in the cross-examination of the defendant, not in my opening statement. An opening statement is exactly that. It's a statement of things that you can prove, and you need to be able to be truthful, and you need to be able to be true to that concept, that you are going to be able to deliver everything that you have said in the opening statement. But before you get to opening statements, almost every trial starts with some form of motion practice. So that's where we want to begin. What do we want to accomplish in motion practice? Anyone have any ideas? If not, I'm going to tell you my ideas, but I'm willing to have a hand. If there's a hand, then someone can say something that's right, wrong, or in between, and then I can correct it. If not, I'll just continue to talk. How about taking a crack at it? What do I want to accomplish in motion practice?
It's like we have Liam Gallagher with his hand up.
Liam, give us those.
Is the goal to try and exclude evidence that may be overly prejudicial to your client?
Sure. That is one thing that you want to do. But I look at it more broadly. I look at it as an opportunity, whether it be a motion, a dispositive motion by a defendant, or a dispositive motion sometimes by the plaintiff, rarely, but sometimes in a civil case, or a motion in limine. But here's what you're really doing. You're educating the judge. Whether you win or lose the motions are an opportunity to educate the judge as to what's going to happen in the trial. Who knows more about the case than the judge? Presumably the attorneys who are litigating the case. You're going to know your case. Your opponent should know their case. If your opponent doesn't know their case, that's all the better. But if you know your case, then you're going to be able to file motions which will perhaps influence the course of the trial. Defendants often file a motion for summary judgment, not because they think they are going to win that motion, really, but because they're going to educate the defendant, the judge, as to some of the weaknesses of the plaintiff's case. Same for the plaintiff. Plaintiff could file a motion in limine, not really thinking that you're going to necessarily win that motion. You want to win that motion, but if you lose the motion, you've also flagged for the judge that when we get this testimony at the trial, this is significant testimony with significant consequences to the trial. So listen up, Your Honor. And motions can do that. Yes, you're correct. Motions also, you file because you want to win those motions. And if you win those motions, that's all the better. Although sometimes you want to be, you want to err with discretion, because sometimes you might not want to win the motion. We often, in cases that we litigate, think long and hard about whether if we get what we ask for, then we might exclude a great cross-examination that can come down the road. Sometimes you want to exclude something, but you can turn that on its head if, in the course of a trial, the evidence comes in a fashion that favors you, and you turn something that would seem like a bad fact into a good fact. So that's motions, voir dire. Now we're on voir dire. The next thing that you do in trial, actually you do a whole bunch of stuff in the trial before you actually give an opening statement, voir dire. How many have participated in voir dire? Have you done voir dire yet in trial? Voir dire is one of the most important parts of the trial, maybe the most important part of the trial. Why? Why is voir dire so important? Because that's going to determine who's going to sit on your jury. And so the jury is going to be the people who decide the case. And in voir dire, you're going to have an opportunity to question the jurors, and you're going to be able to perhaps exclude jurors who have prejudice, bias, sympathy for a plaintiff or against a defendant. Prejudice against a plaintiff, against the party. You have an opportunity to ask questions and perhaps not use your peremptory challenges. Peremptory challenges are challenges which you're given by right. Usually you have three or four, depending on the jurisdiction. And so you have an opportunity to use strikes, but you don't want to use those strikes if you can eliminate jurors who are unfavorable to your case. I look at it as a process of, get this word, if you will, deselection. You never select a jury. You deselect people off of the jury. When people say, how does your panel look? I'm really not interested in necessarily what the panel looks like. I'm interested in focusing in on who I need to eliminate to get a fair and impartial jury for my client. That's voir dire. It's very important. Questions on voir dire? Thoughts on voir dire? I taught a class recently. I was in a first year a contracts class with Dean Oates, and I got everybody to at least talk once. I think I'm going to fail here today, and you're the trial head class, but that's my thinking on voir dire. Next, you get to openings.
Hey, Mr. Klein.
Yes.
I didn't mean to interrupt. You actually do have two questions about voir dire here. You have Okay Harger and Liam Gallagher. Sorry to interrupt.
Please.
Yeah, my question was about, I suppose, we haven't really covered it much at all, but I'm wondering what kind of questions do you ask, I suppose? I'm sure you have like go-to questions that you ask to determine who to deselect during board.
I'm glad that you raised that because I came prepared in my head to say it and I didn't get it out of my head. The number of questions are not important. Quality and content of the questions are what's important. It's not the number, but the information that you elicit. Judges are increasingly impatient with voir dire. Some courts have very limited voir dire. So I want to ask very targeted questions that will get to the core of whether somebody really needs to be eliminated. And there are questions that, by the way, are neutrally balanced, which can get you there. For example, in a medical malpractice case or a product or a drug product case, of which I've tried many in the past few years, you can ask the question, is there anyone who has an experience which is so favorable or so unfavorable with a healthcare provider that you could not be fair and impartial to both sides? That, by the way, is a pretty neutral question, but it gets you a lot of hands. It gets you the people who are in the healthcare community, people who feel that they have a special affinity. I ask questions like that. So you have to think long and hard about your questions. I could spend 2 hours with you on go-to questions, but that's my general view of it. You have to ask good questions, not all questions. The other question that was asked.
Sam, did you put...
I'm sorry. I was going to ask the same thing as Bouquet.
Yeah, great. My concept is how can you formulate a question which gets to the core of a negative juror who would be likely to be against you. In Pennsylvania, you're entitled to actually speak with the jurors. Some judges would prefer if you didn't use all of that time, but we're entitled to talk to the jurors. And of course, you need to quickly form impressions. It is a true exercise in psychology. If you haven't had a psychology course, you probably should have had one because we are at the core practicing some psychology. We're trying to figure out people and how they think and how they're going to react to the case that we're going to bring and the arguments that we're going to make, which takes me to openings. An opening, and this is, I think, the fundamental error that is made by lawyers is to try to turn an opening into a closing. An opening is an articulation of the facts. And that does not mean that you cannot be passionate, that you cannot be expressive, that you cannot give your version of the facts. But at the end of the day, jurors know if you're arguing to them, if you're over the line, if you're just trying to persuade them rather than articulating the facts. I always make that a point. I am here because I have a job to do. My job is to communicate to you in this next half hour the facts that support this claim that you then have to structure the claim within the facts. If you're defending the case, you have to do the opposite. But you need to stick to the facts. And you need to get the core facts out. You need to deal with the facts that are not favorable as well as the facts that are favorable. And you have to tell the jury how you, during the trial, are going to interpret the facts that they're going to see. There's a tendency today in the multimedia world that we live in for everybody to want to show everything from video to cartoons. And there are different philosophies on it, and we could debate that in another hour or two. But my view of it is generally that I want to use my time to talk to people, to make a connection, to let them know who I am, that I am a trustworthy messenger. People want to believe in people that they come to believe in, and people can believe in you very quickly if you convey to them that you have the facts at your command and that you are someone that they can trust. Questions. Notice each section is brief because we're hitting the top of everything so that we can talk about every piece of a trial. Questions on openings. Again, we could do an hour, a 3-hour class, or a day on it. But I want you to have a feel for what an opening should be if you were asked to say what is an opening in 5 sentences.
You have a hand from Nyla.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, good.
I actually had a very delayed voir dire question. So voir dire for a jury is deselection. How would you describe voir dire of an expert witness then?
Well, that's just a different concept. That's a great question. I didn't actually put that in my list. Let's save that for cross exam of witnesses, and I promise to get back to it. We'll put it in its rightful order. Voir dire, and I will talk about it. I'll give you some thoughts on it. We'll hold it. Voir dire of a witness is just a pre-questioning of witnesses, of a witness. We'll get to it on qualifications. Other things on voir dire are openings. Now you know everything you need to know. You never have to finish the course. This is it. You now know what you need on openings. Direct examination. Who thinks direct examination is harder than cross-examination? Who thinks cross-examination is harder than direct examination? What's the consensus? I can't tell, Grace.
Personally, I think direct is harder than cross, and I saw more hands for that too. But you did have a question as well from Alex Maddams. I'm not sure if it was on openings or if you were raising your hand for your vote, but Alex, you do have a question.
Yeah. I had a question about opening statements, actually. So you get up there, you like give your whole like opening statement. How do you know that you've done your job at the end? Like, how do you know that you've convinced the jury that you're trustworthy?
We all react to juries, and I look to the jury to see if I believe that I've connected with them. I look in their eyes. I try to make a personal connection with all the juries without being obvious, but I will talk to various people during the opening. It's nice if people are nodding their heads, but I have had cases where I've had lots of nodded heads and have lost the case. Some people just try to be nice. And they, by the way, they can like you, but not believe in your case. And so you have to, it's an impression. Trials are a lot about impressions and a lot about feeling, Alex. And I believe that you make your best effort and you sit yourself down and you don't play to the jury and you don't try to look for them to love you. You look to make your case. Jurors take cases very seriously. Almost everyone takes jury duty very seriously. And I have found over the years that my best approach is to just try to do my job and be satisfied with myself. I do believe that there is an element left in advocacy, which is better left to individual connection with jurors rather than PowerPoints. The worst mistake the jurors make, that lawyers make, and I think they make it in openings and in closings, is everybody wants to be to do a PowerPoint. Everybody wants to have a crutch, and I think you can have a crutch. By the way, I think your crutch can still be a pad that you have. If you walk in the door at the advocacy center, you see that statue. That guy has a pad in his hand. And that pad has some notes on it. That pad has something written on it, by the way. And that pad contains notes because they aren't barred from a courtroom. And I like to tell jurors that I want to talk to you about something really serious, about the injury that my client had and the way that that happened and how it never should have happened and who's responsible for it. That's what people want to feel. You have to have a feeling, and they have to feel it. Moving on, direct examination. Direct examination, I do believe, is more difficult than cross-examination. Direct examination requires a discipline. It requires your ability to communicate facts in a disciplined, organized fashion. You have a great advantage because you generally have a friendly witness. You generally have a witness who you have sat down with and prepared. There's nothing wrong with doing that. There's nothing wrong with even admitting that during the during testimony. But what direct examination gives you is an opportunity to, in a disciplined, organized way, advance your case. Cross-examination does not necessarily give you the same discipline or the same structure. And that, I believe, is a great advantage of direct examination, with you, whether it be your client or your expert or your lay witness. Cross-examination of witnesses. Of course, if your examination is brilliant, it can fall apart with one question on cross-examination, can't it? I can have the most brilliant and wonderful direct examination of a witness, and defense counsel can stand up and say, well, isn't it true that were not in the crosswalk? Or isn't it true that you knew that this was a heavily traveled road? So what you need to do when you prepare your witness for direct examination is anticipate cross-examination of that witness, because that is the heart of the advocacy system. To get to the voir dire question, voir dire is a way during expert witnesses to put forth the qualifications of the witness. And it's not the same in the terminology exactly as voir dire of a witness. Voir dire means to speak the truth. The terminology voir dire of the witness, generally as an expert witness, refers to an ability before a witness is qualified to question that witness on his or her qualifications. And so that's a separate kind of topic. The most important part there, in my view, is cross-examination of your opponent's witness on voir dire and what you ask him because or her, because you can disqualify a witness before that witness ever gets to say something substantive. Playing it out at trial, there's a witness, the witness is a pathologist. The pathologist is about to testify as to a lot of things that most lay people, in fact, all lay people and most lawyers don't know anything about. You're prepared to cross-examine that witness, but you have a lot of things that you want to cross-examine the person on, like this is a breast cancer pathology case. This witness customarily does not review breast cancer slides on a daily basis. You can make dents in the examination of a witness before the witness actually says something substantive in the case, if you have a well-directed and well-thought-out voir dire, meaning a cross-examination of that witness. Have I handled that question?
Yeah, you did.
Okay. I mean, I think that that's what you're talking about. Oftentimes, I mean, this is a little more in the weeds than I had planned to get, but oftentimes there is collateral cross-examination of a witness having to do with how much money the witness has made, how many times the witness has testified, whether the witness has worked with the particular law firm for whom he's testifying previously. Those are all questions that can be asked, which can ding up a witness pretty good. Not disqualify that witness, but make some dings and dents, depending on how good it is. You've testified in the past, sir, by my count, over 100 times on behalf of a defendant in a medical malpractice case? And how many times have you testified for a plaintiff? One, two, or zero? And if the answer is zero, well, then the jury knows before the person opens their mouth to say anything substantively that this witness has an inherent bias. By the way, if you talk to jurors, they'll tell you, I knew that that witness was a plaintiff's witness. I knew that witness was a defense witness and that that's how they make their living. But that didn't make that witness wrong. But it does go to credibility. And if you can get those credibility issues out early, the earlier you get them out, the better. Because I'd rather the adverse witness talking about things substantively after I've been able to expose who that person really is than having a free rein and then, oh, by the way, on cross-examination, you've testified 100 times on behalf of defendants and never on behalf of a plaintiff. I'd rather the jury know it earlier rather than later. That's the point that I'm making. Now, direct examination, cross-examination, what am I missing? What comes after cross-examination? A really important part of a trial and overlooked. And if you have a couple of takeaways from this that you might remember 1 month, 1 year, 10 years down the road, maybe it'd be this one. What comes next? Direct exam, cross exam, and what comes next?
Okay.
Redirect?
Redirect examination. Most lawyers shy away from it. And it is a really great place to make points. You just testified as to this when defense counsel asked you that. But this also is something that you'd want to add. And by the way, redirect examination, I know it's supposed to be direct examination again, but in every courtroom I've ever practiced in for 40 some years going strong, it's kind of cross-examination again. You get to say all of the things that you're still in cross-examination mode, I might add. Most judges don't stop you. Most lawyers don't object. And it's a real opportunity to make points. Redirect examination. It's the sleeper of examinations in a trial. And so is recross examination. If you're a good examiner, you only need to make a few points. And that's the place where you can really have good examination that can really make a difference. It's a big difference where you put your witness up, somebody cross-examines them, makes a bunch of points. I rarely, sometimes, but rarely, as in really rarely, let something go. I just don't let something go. And if a point has been made on cross-examination, there's some point that can be made to counter it. You remember saying this to defense counsel? Well, let's go back to basics here. Isn't it true that that this and this wouldn't have happened if that didn't happen? And wasn't that happened the fault of his client? That's a good time to make those points. Got it? Shake your head if you got it. That's really a great lesson. Now, there's one more point in the plaintiff's case. And I'm about halfway through this class. I'm about halfway through a trial. And we're going to leave some time at the end for some questions and talking. Calling an adverse witness on cross-examination. There is a way to start a trial on cross-examination. How many have ever thought of it that way? Raise your hand. How many have never thought of it that way? Good. That's what I like. So in any case, you can call an adverse witness and you can call an adverse witness on cross-examination. And while every judge will consistently tell every jury that answers count, questions don't count. How many have heard that one? That's what every judge tells every jury. Listen to the answers, not the questions. Bunk. The fact of the matter is questions count, and questions make an impression on at trials. And so you can call witnesses on cross-examination to make your case. In product liability cases, I forever, as long as I'm trying these cases, and it goes back to the first product liability case I tried in 1983, that is, and where were you all? In all of these trials, I have generally called a corporate witness on cross-examination, loaded for bear with documents. By the way, trials are made up of not only witnesses, but documents. And I know you've been learning how to handle documents, how to admit documents, how to get them into evidence. That's not my purpose today. My purpose is to talk at the high level. And so in calling an adverse witness, it's a great opportunity to put your case in. And oftentimes the answers, I know they'll be prepared answers, but I know that there's no getting through through certain documents. I'll give you an example, and I've tried to stay away from them, but I'll pause here to give you an example. I tried a number of cases involving severe injuries to women involving the use of transvaginal mesh, devices that were designed to treat prolapse in aging women, if I may use that term. And it was a bad idea and bad concept, bad conceptually, badly executed, bad devices, known by drug companies to cause problems. My exhibit A in one of the trials was an email by the inventor of the product on the day it was launched, who in an email said to others, half in jest, this will be something to the words of, this will be interesting to see how it plays out. As for me, I wouldn't implant one in my wife as of yet. By the way, translated from the French into English. I'm going to put a corporate representative up, and I want that to be exhibit A. Would you want that to be exhibit A in your case? And I could put that exhibit in through an expert witness. I could say, is this a document you reviewed? Did you examine this document? Does this form a basis of your opinion? But I could also do it by saying to the adverse corporate representative, how do you explain this one away? And there'll be an explanation, but I think the question is much more effective than what any answer could be. It's not for every case, it's not for every time, but in the formulation of a case and thinking about the whole and what it's going to look like, you might consider calling a witness who's adverse on cross-examination to make the case. Oftentimes in a medical malpractice case, you can call a nurse who knows kind of everything that happened and just get factual information from that person. Or if a doctor makes a particularly poor appearance in deposition, you can call that person adversely as on cross-examination. A downside to it, I believe, on the optics of a trial is cross-examination, would you agree with me, is kind of sort of being a bad guy, bad cop, bad person. It's kind of not a comfortable place to be in the beginning of a trial. I'd like a jury to know that I'm even keeled, even tempered, nice, hope, maybe even nice. And you can do that more easily, obviously, on direct exam. And I often, in a closing arguments, if I think cross-examination has gotten difficult or testy or rough, I'll tell a jury that I hope you understand that that's the adversarial system we have, that that's my job, and it's a search for the truth. There is a reason why you're doing it. To state the obvious, in examinations, even keeled, even tempered, beat them with your brain, not the volume of your voice. That's all. I'm adding that in for free in this lecture, if you will. That is truly a lecture part. All right, so then you get to exhibits. You need to choose exhibits. If you have hundreds of exhibits, you may want to decide that I don't need hundreds of exhibits. I need my 20 best exhibits. I need the 20 best documents. I tried a Risperdal case, which some of you will know about, which I co-counseled with a terrific lawyer in Texas, whose name is Jason Itkin. And he and I made a pact that we would never present a document at the trial that talked about money that was less than in the billions. So we had a document that involved a few hundred million dollar document. My screen went kind of darker all of a sudden. I don't know why. But we decided that we were only going to stick to that formula. Why? Because at the end of the case, I wanted to argue to the jury that this case only translates into billions. There were billions of pills, billions of kids, billions of dollars forecast, billions of dollars made. And so I was trying to prepare them for a decision where the equation was not in thousands, not in tens of thousands, not in hundreds of thousands, but in, and not in millions, and not in tens of millions, and not in hundreds of millions, but in billions in that particular case. Direct examination of defendants comes next, cross-examination of witnesses. That's your opportunity, if you're on the plaintiff side, to do the cross-examination. That should be handled in a disciplined fashion. You need to know what you're doing and what you want to accomplish. No, it is not true. Mr. Klein comes today to disprove the theory that you should never ask a question that you don't know the answer to. How many have heard that? That's actually not true. It's never, Tom Klein theory, never ask a question that you think you can get hurt by. There are questions that you can ask that if you think them through, the answer one way or the other can still be good for you. And then you can take your path from there. Questioning is a pathway. The pathway usually has curves. And so it's not straightforward. You can ask a question that you don't know the answer to. Do all cross-examination questions need to be leading questions? How many think yes? How many think yes? That's generally favored, and that's generally what people think, my friends, but it's not always the case. And sometimes the optics of the cross-examination, if it doesn't matter one way or the other how the answer comes out, or you know the answer is, then ask a non-leading question. Because the jury will get the feel that you actually are being fair to the witness, and you're not just, quote, trying to put words in the other person's mouth. That is something that you hear from jurors often. Once again, redirect examination and recross examination are important component parts. Stipulations are part of every trial, or could be part of any trial. You can stipulate to many things. In our, and stipulations can be read with some fanfare. In the Risperdal trial that is my one reference today. Why not? If you're going to talk about a case, you might as well talk about a case that you won big. But if you're going to have net worth of a defendant to be read to a jury as part of the evidence in the case, then that would be, to Tom Klein's taste, his last piece of evidence where he, the plaintiff's counsel, can stand up in front of the jury, pause for a moment, have a silent room, and say, members of the jury, the parties have stipulated that the net worth of Johnson & Johnson is $70 billion. and then let the silence sink in the room and go sit down. Then stand up again and say, plaintiff rests. There's a stipulation and then there's a way to present a stipulation. And stipulations can be effective if you have a point to make. You can make a point in a trial, by the way, with silence. Just with silence before you ask the next question. I can remember, if it was 20 years ago, it's an underestimate. I think it was more like 30 years ago, and I probably was like your age than my age. And I can remember a defense witness coming in and saying something outrageously stupid and outrageously offensive. And the judge said, Mr. Klein, cross-examine. And I sat there like this. And he said, Mr. Klein? And I looked at the witness and I said, did I hear you to say that? And I repeated what the witness said. And there were some giggles and there were some, the jury got the point. In a trial, you are dealing with human interaction. It's a stage. It's a place where you can command the stage if you have the presence and the mindset to do it, which takes me to closing arguments. That's your real opportunity. You're not going to win a case in a closing argument that you've lost, but you can make a difference in a lot of the outcome of a case if you give a closing argument which is impactful, which is thoughtful, which is human, which is disciplined, and which is carefully delivered. And I've done these in so many different ways, over so many different trials, over so many different years. I've done them with no background. I've done a closing argument 2 years ago in one of the transvaginal mesh cases, which was, if you will, choreographed. I spoke, I knew exactly what I was going to say, and I had a script. There's nothing wrong with that. I had literally a script to follow. If you know the script, and if it's written out or concepts are written out, you can deliver it to the script. And I had one of the junior lawyers in my in our law firm who, behind me, put up the documents that supported everything I was saying. So if you follow that, it was a stage. It was me talking to the jury because I didn't want to lose that. I didn't want to lose the human connection that a trial should be. If there's a takeaway here, Tom Klein told you a trial should be a human connection. You can't substitute for it. You can't substitute for the humanity that goes into a trial where you're asking 12 individuals who have no stake in it to go back and decide the fate of the parties. That's true in a criminal case. It's true in a civil case as well. And then there's rebuttal, which is totally different than the closing. In many jurisdictions, including Pennsylvania, the party with the burden of proof goes first. That would be in the civil case, the plaintiff. And the defendant goes second, and then the plaintiff gets an opportunity for rebuttal. And some of that is spontaneous, but it all doesn't have to be spontaneous, because if you've thought about the trial and you've thought about it as a whole and you've thought about the things that you want to get to say last, the person with the burden of proof has a disadvantage and an advantage. The advantage is that the disadvantage is they have the burden of proof. The advantage is they get to go first and they get to talk last. You get to make first impression and you get to make the last impression. And so sometimes you may want not to say something pre-planned. You know that the defense is going to argue something, and so you don't touch it in your closing argument. Why? I've already given you the answer, because you can't say it at the end and nobody is gonna contradict you. Defense counsel is always gonna get up and say, now, this is my last chance to talk to you and Mr. Klein gets to talk next and I'm not gonna be able to get up and say anything that he said, rebut anything he says. Well, that's right, sir. That's right, ma'am. That is true. And so I'm gonna save some of the best parting shots for the end. Think about it when you're doing your cases now. Think about it when you're actually practicing law. And then the next part of the trial is the jury charge. The judge gets to speak. In a rare venues, there are a few, the judge will give the charge and then the parties will argue, but that's rare. Almost everywhere, the charge will come after it. You need to know the charge and you need to argue your case to what the charge is going to be. You have to fit the juice within the bottle. Don't ever lose sight of that. From the beginning of a trial to the end of the trial, this is what I need to prove. And if you're a plaintiff and you're seeking monetary damages, then they have to know that you're there to seek monetary damages and you need to ask for those monetary damages at the end. You always have to bookend what you're doing. Closing and opening and closing are bookends. And then with time left for questions, 9 minutes left for questions to be exact, this has worked out pretty good. And then you get a verdict. Then you're sitting in the courtroom at your chair and somebody's gonna stand up and a tip staff's gonna say, have you reached a verdict? And a four person is going to stand up and they're going to deliver a verdict. And you're going to be elated or disappointed or somewhere in between. It's going to be hard to hold your emotions and different circumstances call for different actions, but we're professionals and we're lawyers and we're going to take it as though it were part of the job, aren't we? Because that's what we were there for. We're ultimately there to get a jury verdict. And I could go on. I'd love to hear your questions and your thoughts. And I'd like you to also tell me if you think this kind of works or doesn't work, because you've been the first group that I've tried it out on. Let's do a rapid fire of a trial, top to bottom. Grace will open it for questions. And I can hang around. No one's going to be obligated to stay beyond the time frame. But I'm happy to run a little over if anyone would like to.
Question from Bouquet.
Hi. Sorry. I see sometimes that the defense side don't give their opening statements right after the plaintiffs. Like they'll tell the judge, "I'll wait for opening statement for later." Like, why do you think? Do you know what that strategy is about or why they do that?
I've rarely seen it. It does happen. I'll tell you when I think it happens, when it's done the most effective. Although a judge has the right to control a trial. And so different judges would handle it different ways. But let's say you sued three defendants. I think it's a bad idea for a defendant not to give an opening. And most, that's conventional wisdom. You rarely see it. If you're seeing it often, you're seeing different courtroom than I'm seeing. Almost always, they get up and give it. A multi-party case where plaintiff is suing three defendants and they have allied interests, I could see one of them holding back. It'd kind of be another way to give an opening before the defense case starts. For those of you who are uninitiated, the rules in most venues, most jurisdictions allow for a defendant to open before their evidence or immediately after the plaintiff has spoken. And so sometimes on rare occasions, defendant will hold back. It's I have found that extraordinary and unusual.
Question from Bouquet. Question from Arielle Silverman.
Hi. I know that you mentioned that sometimes you have a script written out. How often do you usually write out a script for opening, closing statements, or maybe like just bullet points?
It's really interesting. Do you want to know for the first 20 years or the last 10 years?
Both.
I've been working on a lengthy memoir, so I've been looking at a lot of the stuff that I did when I was a young lawyer, and some of it, by the way, I thought was kind of okay, actually. But I have become more scripted, but I think it's due in, to some extent, to the nature of the complexity of the cases which I've tried over the past 10 to 15 to 20 years. It's easier to be more extemporaneous than not. My speeches, I don't know if any of you have ever come to any of my trials, but my trials are generally, I appear extemporaneous because I don't stay on a, I don't read something. But it's there for me to follow and move along with it. I have this system that I've developed, and maybe it's only good for me, but maybe it's good for somebody else too, where I have everything. I kind of have an idea, a page, and I have large type. That's not because of aged eyes. It's because of the way I've always liked it. And I have usually a big, thick thing. Sometimes I show it to the jury and say, I have a lot to cover. This is not going to be short. They usually smile. I say, but I got a job to do, so I have to do it. And sometimes I'm not written out to the word. I'm written out conceptually. And of course, rebuttals are ideas. It always ends up to some degree, some large degree, extemporaneous, but scripted extemporaneous, if that makes any sense. Other questions?
Mail, did you have another, or you have one from AJ Willis?
I would feel, even if you like think, hey, I have a dumb question and I don't want to ask it, but if you ask it, I'll feel more like loved and homey and touchy-feely if you ask.
Yeah, I was actually wondering if you could speak to the differences you've noticed between in-person trials and then switching over to the Zoom courts, if you will.
Sure. I have not tried a Zoom trial, so I don't know. I selected a jury a couple of weeks ago, and the case settled after jury selection in City Hall, which I found really difficult, where each individual prospective juror was masked at a microphone. We were 20 feet away in a cavernous room. I could barely hear the person. And I thought that it was really a terrible way to conduct a trial. And I didn't look forward to an entire trial of it. I don't think there's any substitute for human connection. And I think that Zoom trials are better than no trials at all, but a far inferior substitute. I'm glad to see that we're back to real trials. And I think that I don't think Zoom trials are going to be the wave of the future. I think Zoom business for lawyers and Zoom conferences are going to be a thing for the future. There's so much that's gained by being in the same room with other people, as you well know. In the middle of the pandemic, when I was told, hey, you can, come speak to my class and we'll do it by Zoom, I thought, wow, this is easy. When I heard today was Zoom, I was disappointed that I wasn't in a room with all of you. It's just a different thing. Next question. Keep them coming. we'll cover a little territory before we call it a day.
Half one, excuse me, from Liam Gallagher.
Well, Mr. Klein, thank you for speaking to us today, but do you have any just general tips for young lawyers starting out and looking to get into litigation work?
Find a good mentor is what I always say. I learned from the late, great James E. Beasley by watching him. Jim wasn't a teacher per se, but Jim gave you the opportunity, at least for me and for my law partner, Shane Spector, to watch a great lawyer work. I don't think I became Jim Beasley, although I did get the idea that naming a law school is kind of a cool thing to do. And then you get to watch a whole generation and other generations become lawyers. But I watched Jim and I took what I thought were some great ideas by obviously great trial lawyer. I think that you should, as a trial lawyer, watch those things. You're not going to spend every day in the courtroom. I spend probably a disproportionate amount of my professional time, pre-pandemic anyway, actually in a courtroom. Most lawyers aren't in a courtroom. They're in depositions and other developmental aspects of trial practice. But what I learned over the years, much of it I learned from watching other lawyers, from watching the good, the bad, and the ugly. And you can learn an awful lot by seeing mistakes. So I suggest that what you do is you yourself become a critic of what you are, what you're observing. Every day is a laboratory. And so if you go to a deposition, you'll come back and you'll think that was crappy questioning. That was dumb to ask my client this or that. Or you might think, wow, that was really, really bright. Don't be afraid to compliment somebody either. There's no penalty points for giving somebody a compliment, but I usually save them for when they're really true, or when I'm trying to psych somebody out, telling them that, hey, that was really a great cross-examination when it really was crappy. But that's kind of part of being a trial lawyer too. Next question.
We have two. We'll do Ariel and then Andrew.
Sure. Ariel?
I have another question. How did you first, or when did you figure out that you were interested in medical malpractice?
Well, I got a job. I mean, there's a kind of a longer history to this because I, that has some personal roots, which you can read about someday in chapter one of the memoir. Paul Davies, who's writing that, is somewhere on this screen with us, by the way. He's monitoring this today. But for me, I went to work for a firm that had a heavy component of medical malpractice cases. I went to work for the Beasley firm. And so it was there. I wanted to be a trial lawyer. I knew I wanted to represent people who were injured and who were seeking redress in the courts. I knew that that I was temperamentally and psychologically suited for that job, all of which was good. And medical malpractice happened to be one of those areas that that firm practiced in. And so I developed a very quick understanding of those cases. And so it was where I worked and the work that I was able to do. You know, it brings to mind, if you really want to do something, you stick to it and you do that kind of work. Professional satisfaction, this is not the topic of the day, but professional satisfaction is so important, everyone. It's just so important that you do something that you like. Not everybody's cut out to be a trial lawyer. Not everyone's cut out to do this. You're doing the trial advocacy track is a great opportunity for you to actually learn and figure out if this is something you really like and really want to do. I've thrived on it. Any day that I can get up and go to a courthouse and be in a real trial before people is a sunshine day. regardless of what the weather is like outside. And some of us just love to live like that and love to do it. But part of it had to do with the fact that I was doing work that I thought was appreciated and respected. And by the way, I have, from the first day that I set foot in a courtroom until literally a day this week, this past week when I appeared in court, every day I believe that I need to prove myself again. I need to, it's not just I'm walking in there and I'm Tom Klein, and they want to know what you know, and that you know your case, that you know your facts, that you know the law, and that you are a trusted messenger. Judges know the difference. And so you have to earn it when you're a young lawyer, and you have to earn it when you're an older lawyer. You never stop earning that respect and that trust, in my view. There was another question.
Yeah, Mr. Klein, thanks for being with us again.
My pleasure.
So this week we just finished up our work doing impeachments on cross-examination. And I know it can kind of get routine, but Professor Stern shared a story about handing a witness a pen to circle an area in a testimony that contradicted a prior statement. And I was wondering if you had any stories of creative impeachments or any advice to sort of spice it up so it's not so routine.
A lot of them. I can remember like it was yesterday, a deposition that took place in the 1990s. The case involved and Grace, I'm mindful of time too, by the way. And for those of you of other stuff, you can shed off. That's okay with me. I can remember like it was yesterday, the case involved a boxer who was injured in a boxing match at a gym called Champs Gym in North Philadelphia. He had a subdural bleed. He got whacked in the head by a guy who was a former heavyweight champion or a championship contender. And he sat in an emergency room waiting to be transferred after a CAT scan revealed that he had the bleed. And he needed to have that bleed evacuated. And I was cross-examining the defense expert. And he was making the point that the nurses had done their job. They called for an ambulance and the ambulance didn't arrive. And I was making the point that the ambulance didn't arrive because they made no effort to get the ambulance there and flag the emergency. And so I asked him the question. The question just came to my mind. I didn't have it written down. I didn't have it pre-thought out. And he was being a bit of a wise guy with me. And I said to him, you ever order food out? And he said, yeah. I said, pizza? He said, no, that gives me heartburn. He was that kind of wise guy. He had an answer for everything. I said, how about Chinese food? He said, yeah. Yeah, we order Chinese food out. I said, and what happens when you order your Chinese food? By the way, this isn't in the day of Uber Eats. This is, you know, this is 1990 something. I said, what happens when you order your Chinese food and you and it doesn't come? You call back? And he said, yeah. I said, well, don't you think that Dennis Richardson deserve the same treatment from the nurses who you're trying to defend that you give to yourself when you're ordering Chinese food and it doesn't show up for half an hour? And do you think there were any objections? That's not an objectionable question, by the way. It's just an analogy. And we forever dubbed that witness Pizza Kelly. His name was John Kelly. I always called him Pizza Kelly from there on out. And it was one of those hundreds of cross-examinations, I'm sure, but one that sticks in my mind since you asked me for one that stuck in my mind. What do you think of that?
I think it's great. It's really funny.
Yeah, I mean, well, that's right. That's right. It was all done in, you know, it was all done in a sense of humor. I had a case involving the death of a obstetrician who was getting fertility treatment, who was bleeding to death and died at the hands of another physician. An expert came in and he looked at the wrong chart with the wrong data. He was looking at the husband's chart, because in fertility treatment, there's a chart for the husband and the wife because they're trying to match up all of the puzzles in the jigsaw puzzle. And eventually when I showed him the error, I asked him two questions at the end. I asked him, when he pointed out the error, I asked him, "Are you embarrassed?" It's a favorite question of mine, by the way. Are you embarrassed? When you just have someone admitting that they're wrong. And I said, "Are you embarrassed?" And he said, "Yes." And the next question I asked him, it was 4:20 in the afternoon on a Friday. And he was about to catch a plane. I happen to know that from hallway chatter. You got to keep your ears open. And I said to him, "You better leave, sir, because you're going to be late for your plane back to Chicago." Jury laughed as he walked off of the stand. Those moments don't happen every day, but they do happen. And they're part of what makes what we do fun. What we do, I mean, we have this great luxury. We are actually compensated for having fun. And cross-examination is a fun part of the trial. But here's the caveat. Did Andrew ask me that question, I think? But here's the caveat to it. Don't have too much fun, and don't get ahead of your skis, and don't think too much of yourself. So I had a case back in 1986. A lot of my stories go back a ways, and involved a little child and a premature infant who had a procedure where they needed to tape down his little tiny fingers. He was 2 pounds. And the resident physician nipped his finger with a scissors, taking the bandage off, causing literally an amputation of this itty bitty 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 finger. And Children's Hospital of Philadelphia wanted to pay, I don't know, $50,000 for that claim. It was the tip of a finger. And Mr. Big Shot, young lawyer, Tom Klein, wanted more and wanted his day in court for these clients. And we tried the case and we got a jury verdict. And the jury awarded $250,000, which was more than a fair sum, I might add. I was unhappy. I kind of picked myself up grumpily. This is in the do as I say, not do as I did category. And I walked out kind of, ugh, ugh. I didn't want to talk to anybody, didn't want to see anything. I got back to the office and I happened to be sitting at my desk. My phone rang. I picked up my phone. It was the trial judge. And he said to me, "Tom, you know what?" His name was Judge Goodhart, Bernard Goodhart. He used to marry people on Valentine's Day. That was his claim to fame. Get it? Judge Goodhart. And he said to me, he said something kind at first. "You're a pretty good lawyer." He wouldn't get beyond that. Trust me. He was not full of compliments. But he said to me, "You know what your big problem is?" I said, "What?" "What, Your Honor?" He said, "You tend to believe your own bullshit." And of course, that's part of the problem that we have in the courtroom, isn't it? That we like to think that we're the case, we're the story, we're the theater. When in fact the cases involve discrete facts, and you have to get the facts on your side. You can marshal the facts, but then you have to have the facts to work with. You have to be able to win the case and win what you work with. I came back from court one day and I was at the Beasley firm. I was a young lawyer and I just lost the case in my hands. Literally, my hands were in my face. My law partner, Shane Spector, came in and told me something which I'll never forget. He said to me, "You think this case was a referendum on you," which it wasn't. It was a referendum on the facts, and you didn't have the facts and you deserve to lose the case. And I picked myself up and I turned to the next file, because there's always something else to do for somebody else, isn't there? Always something for some, always something to do, and always some other cause, and always somebody to advocate for, somebody to defend. That's my message. I think I've run over, Grace, but I enjoyed being here, and I hope that you all got a little bit out of it.
Yeah, that was incredible. Thank you so much, Mr. Klein, for being here. Why don't we give a virtual round of applause?
Yay.
You can't hear any of the claps.
So good luck to everybody. Good luck in trial teamwork. Good luck in this course. And I'm easy to find. I'll see you around campus.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Klein.
My pleasure. Nice to be here.
Thank you, Mr. Klein.
You're welcome. I'm leaving Grace too.
Okay. I was gonna try and say he might have people who want to stay after and introduce themselves, but I think he actually has another presentation at the school in like.
It's Monday, I think. I'm gonna go. It's in person.
Oh, is it? Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. You're right. It is Monday. But yeah, that was awesome.
Thanks, Grace.
Yeah, I'll see you later. Text me.
Yes, bye.